start with a Rigvedic prayer today. I have, you know, told you that every class will start with some new prayer so that incidentally you will learn something new. So today, since I am going to talk about Rigveda in the Chaturdasha Vidyasthana, so let me start with a Rigvedic prayer to Saraswati. Okay? Chodayitri Sunrutanam Chetanti Sumatinam Yajnam Dadhe Saraswati. Saraswati is Chodayitri. She is the motivator. She inspires. She impels. What? Sunrutanam, our nice talk, good speech. So she is the inspirer of good speech. And Chetanti Sumatinam, she also motivates and awakens us, the goodness in our mind. Sumati, goodness of mind. So Chetanti Sumatinam, so Chodayitri Sundrutanam, Chetanti Sumatinam, Yajnam Dadhe Saraswati. Such Saraswati holds, Dadhe, Dharan Karti Hai, holds what? Yajnam. Such Saraswati holds yajna, that is sacrifice is a too, what you say, insufficiently translated word for yajna. I call this lecture series as Jnana Yajna, and therefore I would rather say that this is the Saraswati who is inspiring me, you and all others who have joined this class, you know. So she is the inspirer. And this is the Jnana Yajna which she holds. We are only Nimitta Matra. Okay? So with this little introduction now, let us go to today's topic. Today we are going to see Chaturdasha Vidyasthana. Last lecture we saw 64 kalas. Chaturdasha, that is 14 Vidyasthanas. It is loosely translated as L-O-R-E, lore in English. So 14 lores, that is branches of knowledge, and 64 kalas, that is the fine arts, that comprises the entire group of knowledge. Okay? So let us today deal with the Chaturdasha Vidyasthanas. So what you see here is a tree. The tree looks all blossomed, all green. But will it be green forever? What causes that greenery? What causes that blossom? That is, oh, chlorophyll, that's okay. But if there are nothing in the down which is deeply going into the soil, what are they? The roots. So if there are no roots, there won't be any tree. Right? Do you agree? So the roots are more important. And what are the roots? The roots are in the Chaturdasha Vidyasthana and the 64 kalas. Okay? So now in this, we will see how one-to-one correspondence is there. What we see up above is the college, so many institutions, higher education institution which we go to. But what is there literally is the university which promotes knowledge. Okay? In college, what do? You study so many courses. But what are these courses? They develop the skill and right type of attitude in the students. So what is at the root of the courses? It is the skill development, skill enhancement, right? Similarly, whatever you see above, it has something below the roots which is not seen. But unless it is there, whatever you see above, the bahya thing, they won't flourish. So there is a job, but before that you have to have a career in your mind. Accordingly, you choose a job. Then there is a standard of living, but what is at the root is standard of life. Living is something different and life is quite other, right? So what you get now here is a degree. You go to college, learn some courses, get a degree. On the basis of the degree, you get a job and improve your standard of living. But what is at the base of that is knowledge. And this knowledge, I would say, Indian knowledge systems, that is the IKS. What we are going to talk about, right? First two lectures also we talked about that, but the Chaturdasha Vidyasthana would come now. So IKS, in that, before we go to that IKS, what are all these, you know, the flourishing branches of knowledge which are contemporarily experienced by us, which are chosen by our young students, you know? These are like theatrical art, astronomy, sociology, psychology, linguistics, supply chain management, in management, right? Medicine, surgery, biology, archaeology, geography, commerce, economics, maths, astrology, so many branches of knowledge which are there. But at the root of that, what we have is Indian knowledge systems, and in that, four Vedas, four Upavedas, and six Vedangas. Four Vedas, the Rigveda, Yajurveda, Samaveda, Atharvaveda. Then the four Upavedas, that is Ayurveda, Dhanurveda, Gandharvaveda, and Sthapatyaveda. And the six Vedangas, Shiksha, Kalpa, Vyakarana, Nirukta, Chanda, Jyotisha. See how they are related to each other. You can just draw some arrows, you know, this is borrowed from this. This can be traced in this particular ancient Indian knowledge systems. So there are so many branches of knowledge which we see around us today, but they are all rooted somewhere in some one, two, or multiple of the Vidyasthanas. They are collectively known as Chaturdasha Vidyasthana. Chaturdasha Vidyasthana is the collective name for all that. Now, with this Chaturdasha Vidyasthana, we give it in a nutshell here. Vedas, the four Vedas. Okay? Now, in that, Rigveda is mostly comprises of prayers, the suktas, the hymns. Richam Vedaha, Rigvedaha. Rich is a prayer. A prayer. Okay? So, this is the Veda of the prayers. Then Yajurveda, it is ritualistic in nature, Yajurveda, Yajusham Vedaha, Yajurvedaha, and Yajush, this particular noun is derived from the root Yaj. Yaj is to make, to prepare, to perform a Yajna, sacrifice in English, okay? But that is too insufficient, avyapti. Yajurveda, Yajusham Vedaha, Samnam Vedaha, Samavedaha. Samaveda 90% is Rigveda, I tell you. But Rigvedic verses, the Ruch, are chanted, recited, whereas Samaveda verses are sung. They are put to melodious tune, they are sung. In the first class, I think, we did refer to it, very briefly, that it is the Veda, which is Upaveda, which comes out of that is Gandharva Veda, and some of the Gandharvas are named as Haha and Huhu. Right? So, this is musical in nature. Atharva Veda is more philosophical in nature. Why so? I will tell you sometime later when we come to Atharva Veda. But I might tell you right now that one of the names of Atharva Veda is Brahma Veda. And Brahma means a prayer. Brahma means a philosophical principle. Brahma means a chant, incantation. Okay? So, Brahma Veda. So it is philosophical in nature. Of course, there are so many other things like black magic, hypnotizing a thing, okay? And therefore it is called Black Veda also. More of that when we deal with Atharva Veda. Let your curiosity be intact till then. So these are the four Vedas. Then the four Upavedas are Ayurveda. Of the Rigveda, it is Ayurveda, which is life science. Then for Yajurveda, it is Dhanurveda, which is weaponry. Martial art, okay, Kshatra Veda. Then Sama Veda, it is Gandharva Veda, fine arts, all music, drama, performing arts, everything. And Atharva Veda, it is Sthapatya Veda, which is the knowledge of architectural buildings, engineering skills and what not. Okay, so Vastu Nirmana, Shala Nirmana, Devalaya Nirmana, all these architectures, even digging up a well, step well, for which India is known for, right? So all this comes under architecture, Sthapatya Veda. And even now in South, the architect is called Sthapati. Sthapati is an architect, okay? And then there are six Vedangas. Shiksha deals with the art of pronunciation. It is Uchcharana Shastra, okay? And then there are so many pratishakhyas and all. Maybe we can do little bit from Paniniya Shiksha sometime. Then kalpa are the rituals. In kalpa again there are 3-4 types, you know, kalpa sutras. There are shrauta sutras, there are dharma sutras, there are griha sutras, and there are shulba sutras. Shulba sutras and shrauta sutras go together because they are concerning with the building up of a yajna vedi, an altar where the offerings are offered to the fire god. Okay, so shrauta sutra and shulba sutra go together. Dharma sutra are all the sanskaras, okay, the shodasha sanskaras, right from garbhadhana pumsavana to shraddha dantyeshti. And then griha sutras are the code of conduct, so to say, the various ashramas, the various varanas, their dharmas, their characteristics, their apad dharmas, all those things they come under griha sutras. Then there is vyakarana. We know that Panini, the greatest grammarian of the world, he composed the vyakarana sutras. Then nirukta, this is the science of etymology. Nirvachanam, niruktam, nighantu, nirukta, they come together. Nighantu is a glossary of Vedic words and nirukta is a commentary on that nighantu. Then chandas is prasodi, chandas shastra, the sutras written by Pingala. And then jyotisha is astronomy. Falita jyotisha, which is very popular these days, is just a part of astronomy, the astrology, the popular, you know. In every nook and corner we have some shop of some famous astrologer. That is the Falita Jyotisha, the Jataka or the Kundali, that forms just a part of that. Real meaning of Jyotisha is the science of the stellar world, the shining, the illuminary bodies in the heaven. Okay, so that is the Jyotisha, which without Ganita, without mathematics, it can't flourish. So Jyotishi, which was later on turned into a surname called Joshi. We have the surname Joshi all over India, right from south to north, right? This is not just a Joshi, this is a Jyotishi. Jyotishi became Joshi later on, right? So these are the 14 Vidyasthanas. But apart from that, in the first lecture, if you remember, I had referred to some other shastras like Mimamsa, Dharma Shastra, Ramayana, Mahabharata. So what are they and where can they be fit in? There are 4 more Vidyasthanas. These are the 4 more Vidyasthanas: Itihasa Puranani, Itihasa Ramayana and the Mahabharata, and the Purana, the 18 Puranas, 108 Puranas, 1008 Puranas. The number goes on increasing. Then Nyaya Shastra, Anvikshiki it is called, that is the logic, the science of reasoning. Tarka Shastra, that is Nyaya. Then Mimamsa, this is the science of interpretation of the Vedic statements. In popular Western world, it is called as hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is the science of interpretation, okay? And then there is Dharma Shastra, which deals with more to the people and their conduct. These are the rules and regulations of behavior, behavioral psychology, something like that we are learning today, right? Psychology students? Yes. So behavioral science, code of living. So if you add these 4 to the first 14, it becomes 18. But the popular phrase, however, is Chaturdasha Vidyasthana. With the addition of these 4, which are called Upangas, Vedas, Upavedas, Vedangas, and these 4 are Upangas, the subordinate limbs of the Vedic literature. Okay? Upanga. So they become 18 in number. Lot to learn. In that, we will concentrate first on the Veda. What does Vedic literature comprise of? And in that also in particular, I would like to dwell more on Rigveda today. Other Vedas we can eventually, not in a chronological order, but sometimes later we can deal with those. So Veda, it is derived from the root Vida. Now root Vida there are four roots of four different meanings in Sanskrit. Okay? Veda is basically the key to the hidden treasure of Indian knowledge tradition. Therefore, there is a key. IKT or IKS, what is the key? I told you in the first lecture, all this knowledge is stored in a box and the key is Sanskrit. If Sanskrit is lost, the treasure is lost for us. We can't unearth the treasure then. So, vida is to be or to exist. Vida vidyate, it is divadi gana, chaturtha gana. Vida to know, vida sattayam vidyate, okay? Vida sattayam vidyate. Then vida to know, jnane vetti. Vetti is adadi gana, dadvitiya gana. Vida to discuss, to ponder over is vinte, vicharane. It is ridhadi gana, saptama gana. And then vida to obtain, vindate or vindati, praptau, to obtain. That is from the sixth tudadi gana. So there are four different roots. I mean, the root is the same, the meanings are different. And for the Rashi, for the word Veda, all these four meanings apply equally. Veda exists, Veda is knowledge, Veda gives us lots of topics to think about, to ponder over, to contemplate upon, and Veda is the means to obtain so many things, whether the mundane, the empirical things or the adhyatmika things, the transcendental development of one's soul, you know. So many things are there to be acquired from the Vedo Rashi. Then Veda is unfathomable ocean of knowledge. What is called is Vedokhilo Dharma Moolam. The entire root of the Sanatana Dharma, the Indian Dharma, lies in the Veda. And Mantra Brahmana Yoho Veda Namadheyam, I had told it in the first lecture, Samhita or Mantra, then Brahmana, Aranyaka and Upanishad. These are the four parts of Vedic literature, right? Sayanacharya, 14th century, Amatya of Hariharan book, the Vijayanagar, great empire of Vijayanagar in the 14th century, Sayanacharya, he has written in his commentary, what is the purpose of Veda? Ishta Prapti Anishta Pariharartham. Ishta Prapti, Vida Vindati Praptau, okay? So, Ishta Prapti, whatever you desire, you get thereby, and Anishta Pariharartham, whatever is not favorable, Pariharartham, to dispel that, Veda does what? Alaukikam Upayam Yo Vedayati Savedaha. That scripture or that Shastra, which gives you, which indicates the means, the device by which you get what you desire and you dispel or remove or get rid of what is undesirable. Ishta Prapti Anishta Pariharartham Alaukikam Upayam Yo Vedayati Savedaha. Unfortunately, the key is lost. Unfortunately, the key is lost, and therefore we are plunged into the darkness because we are not giving much attention to the language Sanskrit, wherein all this knowledge is written. What is the origin of Veda? There is no origin, in fact. But still, you know, in the Vedic literature itself, we have got some two, three different theories. I am not going beyond Vedic literature. Whatever sources I get from the Vedic literature, I have told it here. For example, in the Purusha Sukta 1090, it is there in the Rig Veda, it is Yajurveda, Samaveda, in all the four Vedas, Purusha Sukta is there with little bit of difference. So from the cosmic sacrifice, Ruchas Sama Nijadnire, so that is that Yajustasmad Ajayata, okay? And then Atharva Veda has one Sukta called Skambha Sukta. Skambha is Stambha, a pillar, okay? So from that pillar, all these Vedas emerged. For example, Ruch and Yajus were carved out of that, and Sama is the hair, and Atharvangiras is the face of that pillar. The top portion of the pillar is Atharvangiras. So some such origination of Vedic literature is given in Skambha Sukta. In Atharva Veda itself, there are so many theories. I told you Atharva Veda is, many people blacklist it, you know, as a black Veda. And many times we have a reference only to Vedatrayi. Ruk, Yajus and Sama, Atharva Veda is not considered because of the black magic component in it. But that's only a 1/6 portion. That is only 1/6 portion, not so great, right? So there are many things which are philosophical in nature, and this is what we get in that. So Vedas are created from Kala, Vedas are created from the Uchishta of sacrifice. Yajnochishta it is called. Yajnasya Uchishta, a remnant of a sacrifice, Yajna. And Vedas are but a breath of the highest Brahman. Tasya Nishvasitametad Yat Rugvedaha. Nishvasitametad. It's just an exhalation. The highest principle exhaled, and there came about the Rugveda, Yajurveda, and all that. So that is in the Shatapatha Brahmana, which belongs to Yajurveda. Nirukta again says, the science of etymology, Sakshatkrita Dharmanaha Rushayo Babhubuhu. The rishis to whom the Vedic hymns or suktas are ascribed or assigned to, they are Sakshatkrita Dharmanaha. The Vedas got revealed to them. They did not took a pen and a pencil and wrote it on the piece of paper and a leaf. Birch bark or a palm leaf, you know. Sakshatkrita Dharmanaha. These were revelations. They saw the Vedas. And therefore, in Laukikartha, in the mundane definition, there are the Vedas are not composed by anybody. They are not man-made. And therefore, they are called as apaurusheya. In fact, Rugveda Bhashya Bhumika, before commenting upon the Rugveda as such, Sayanacharya has written a long prologue, that is Bhashya Bhumika, prologue to write a Bhashya on Rigveda, and in that he has dwelt much deeply into the apaurusheyatvam Vedanam, how the Vedas are apaurusheya. So I won't go much into detail. Those who are curious to know can go to Rig Bhashya Bhumika of Sayanacharya. So Veda is primarily knowledge. Sarvajnanamayohisaha Vedaha. So Veda is primarily knowledge. Then the highest knowledge, first just knowledge. Then gradually we go further, highest knowledge, and later the sacred hidden knowledge. And thus we see a gradual development in the connotation of Veda. Okay? The denotation and connotative meaning, both are different. Now this Veda was Sarvajnana Mayohi Saha. Veda is only one, it was said. Then how do you get these four Vedas, Rug, Yajus, Sama, Atharva? It was Veda Vyasa who gave these four, I mean he Vivyasa Vedan, Chaturaha, Ataha Veda Vyasa iti Uchyate. He divided the entire Veda Rashi into four parts and gave each part to each one of his disciples. So the Rigveda was given to Paila. Vyasa gave Rigveda to his Shishya Paila. Yajurveda he gave to Vaishampayana. Then Samaveda to Jaimini and Atharva Veda to Sumantu. He is called Veda Vyasa because Vivyasa Vedan Chaturaha. Chatura is not he Chatura, Chatura is Chatvara. Okay? So Chatvara Veda. He divided, he analyzed according to the contents into four parts, and therefore they are known to be like Rig, Yajus, Sama and Atharva. Now what are the main subject matters of all the Vedas? There are so many things, but if you just take a general review sort of thing, you know, then what all we can get in the four Vedas, rituals, basically the Vedic literature is ritualistic in nature. Yajna is the main Sanskriti. Yajna Sanskriti is the main Sanskriti, okay? That is the main civilization. Yajna, I think I told you last time, Yajna is not just a sacrifice. It has three basic invariable components in it, constituents you can call it, Dravya, Devata and Tyaga. Dravya, Devata and Tyaga. Dravya, some vastu, some object. You have to abandon it, sacrifice that. Idam na mama, indraya idam, idam na mama. Idam na mama iti vrittya, tat tyaktavyam. Sacrifice, tyaga. For whom? Devatam uddishya. So some devata is there. And devata need not be like, you know, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, Ganesha, Durga, Katyayani, etc. This could be anything, even the mortar and the pestle, ulu kala musala, is called a devata in the Rig Veda. Aksha, last time I told you about the Aksha Sukta in the Kalas, Aksha is a devata. Devata is not a god, in which sense we are using it today. Devata is yam uddishya suktam virachyate or suktam drishyate sosya devata. I think it will come in the next slide. So basically it is ritualistic by nature, all the Vedas. Then cosmology, how this world was created. Koham kastvam kutayataha, the basic quest to know who am I, who are you, from where we were all born, who is the creator, all that stuff. So cosmology, basically we find these hymns in the Rig Veda and Atharva Veda, major, these are the major sources. Agriculture is again Rig Veda and Atharva Veda, we have many suktas, Krishi suktas are there. Hydrology, about water, it is Yajurveda, basically, you know, in Yajurveda, Namaka and Chamaka, you get so many varieties of water reservoirs, okay, we'll deal with it sometime. Then sociology, all the four Vedas, because right from the Panchajana to the Dasharadnya Yuddha, you know, there are wars, the battles fought, and Akho Dekha Hal, you know, like somebody has witnessed that and he is describing Vasishtha, for example, in the seventh mandala. So all sorts of social people, their behavior, all that is covered in this sociology in all the four Vedas. And philosophy basically is Rig Veda and the Atharva Veda. Vedic deities, yasya vakyam sa rishihi, one who utters that, one who just articulates that mantra, he is the rishi. Rishir darshanat, rishi is a seer, he is not a thinker, just not a thinker, he is a seer, he is a visionary, he is a drashta. Visionary, he sees behind and you know over and above what other people can see. Jo na dekhe kavi, jo na dekhe ravi, so dekhe kavi, right? So that is the rishi. Ya tena uchyate sa devata, ya tena rishina uchyate sa devata, yad akshara parimanam tachandaha. And there is a rule, you know, without knowing the rishi, devata and chanda, you should not study any Rigvedic sukta. Okay? And there is one more, prayojanam. Because prayojanam anuddishya mandopina pravartate. Okay? Without prayojana, without a purpose, nobody, even a fool doesn't do anything. So these are all rishis. So there must be some prayojana for that mantra. Then devata is varanya vishaya, and therefore natural phenomena are mostly deified there. First, there is a natural phenomena like prithvi, aap, tej, vayu, akash. Okay, the pancha mahabhutas, the five gross elements. Then they are humanized. That is, personification is there. And the last stage is apotheosis, which is deification. Turn them into God. Turn them into deity. Okay? So like that we have so many rishis deifying the natural phenomena. What sort of natural phenomena are there? Like as Yaskacharya says in his text etymology, Nirukta, Tisro Vai Devataha. There are only three types of deities. Prithivi Sthaniyaha, Antariksha Sthaniyaha, Dyusthaniyasya. There are only three types of deities. They are either terrestrial, prithivi sthaniya, mid-region atmospheric deities, or celestial, heavenly deities. So whatever deities are there in the Rig Veda, you can classify into these three categories. Now one example if I take of teja tattva, because I was talking to you that these are all natural elements which are deified. So teja, that is agni. Now if you take the teja as the natural phenomena, the heavenly body is the sun. What is the heavenly body of teja? Tejo gola, that is the sun. What is the atmospheric body of teja? That is lightning, vidyut, that is lightning. And what is the terrestrial form of that teja? Agni, fire. Fire, okay. Fire could be the wildfire as recently we had in Australia, right? Or that could be fire in the Yajnavedi, any fire, or the fire around which we sit, bonfire, that is also fire, okay? So fire is the terrestrial, vidyut, apam napat it is called in Rigveda, that is the atmospheric, and sun is the heavenly. So one teja element in three different spheres, three different realms or regions, you find three different deities. And in the heavenly bodies again, it's not only one sun in the Rigveda. There are dvadasha adityaha. So Bhaga is there, Pushan is there, even Vishnu is a solar deity, Indra is a solar deity, right? Similarly, you take the aptatva, jala tattva, water, the principle of water. Water you can have in the form of streams and rivers flowing on the earth, okay? You can have water as pure principle which purifies you. You can have the rain water which comes from the atmosphere. And then for that rain phenomena to happen, there are clouds, there are winds, and there have to be some governing deity who is the officer of all the clouds, and that is Indra. So many gods are related with the rain phenomena as such, or the water principle as such. So that is the scope of these natural phenomena getting personified and getting deified. And that is why and that is how the number of deities goes on increasing. Basically, there are two tattvas, Agnishomatmakam Jagat. The entire universe is made up of two basic things, heat and moisture. Heat and moisture, these are the two basic things which have to be there for any creation, be it cosmos, be it a human being. Heat and moisture, and therefore Nara and Nari. Nara and Nari, heat and moisture. So heavenly body, sun, mid-region, etc., water principle we saw. So these are the various things. Then again, Indra is the most, what you can say, popular, most glorified deity, god of the Rigveda. There are around 1054 suktas, hymns. Every sukta will have number of verses. Some will have just 2, 3, some have 8, 10, some will have 43 and 63 also. Okay? So the number of ruchas, the verses would be more than 10,000. 1054 is the number of the suktas. Out of that, more than 250 are ascribed to Indra. Indra alone. References to Indra, Dvandva Devata, Indra and Vayu, Indra and Mitra, Indra and Varuna, there are still more. Okay? Alone to Indra, more than 250 hymns. After Indra, the next popular deity is Agni. Almost 200 and more, 200 plus hymns are ascribed to Agni. In the Rigveda, the very first hymn of Rigveda is Agni Sukta. Agni Mile Purohitam Yajnasya Devam Ritvijam Hotaram Ratnadhatamam, etc. We may take one or two suktas of the Rigveda. Then after that, Soma, Pavamana, Soma has got 114 hymns ascribed to Soma. An entire ninth book of the Rigveda. There are 10 mandalas called 10 books. Okay? So the ninth section, ninth mandala is entirely Pavamana mandala. Soma's name is Pavamana. We'll see that later. Then Ashwina, it is 43 hymns. Ashwina is the twin Ashwini Kumara, we call them, two young boys who are the physicians of the gods. Normally we talk of them as physicians of gods. Then Surya, there are 40 hymns, Maruts, 35 Maruts servants, and Ushas, the early dawn. She has some 17 hymns. Besides these important deities, there are hymns for Rudra, which is a prototype of Shiva, you can say. Now we call in the Purana Itihasa Shiva, but the earlier Devata is Rudra. And therefore, in Yajurveda also, there is Rudra Patana, Rudra Adhyaya, Chamaka Namaka, etc. Then Vishnu, Parjanya, Brihaspati, Dyava, Prithivi, heaven and earth, they become the Devata. Then rivers, Saraswati, Saraswati, there are three full hymns of for Saraswati. Maho Aranaha Saraswati, It's a mighty torrential stream with which Saraswati flows. Where is Saraswati now? Desiccation of Saraswati. It got dried up. During the Mahabharata period only, it got dried up. But in the Rigvedic period, she was the mightiest of rivers. We have the reference to Ganga only in the 10th mandala. In the Rigveda, only in one hymn, we have a reference to Ganga. But Saraswati, there are so many references. In fact, the earlier, I started the class with the Saraswati mantra, that is from that hymn of Saraswati. There are three mantras, I chose the middle one. And the hymns to Aksha, hymns to Manduka, and the mortar and the pestle I was telling you. So there are various types of deities. The outer structure of Rigveda. I told you, after dealing with Veda in general, let us concentrate more on Rigveda as such. Okay? So Rigveda, what is the structure of that? It is basically Rucham Vedaha, Rigvedaha. Okay? Now the structure wise, there are two types of, you know, analyzing the contents of the Rigveda. One is the traditional method, which is called Ashtaka method, and the other is the modern method in which we studied, I mean the university people study, that is the Mandala method. Okay? So the Ashtaka method is, there are five ruchas, any five ruchas from the first hymn, for example, five mantras you choose, that becomes one varga. Why only five ruchas, you know? Because Ashtavarsham Brahmanam Upanayita. Normally, in the eighth year, a Brahmana undergoes the Maunji Bandhana, the Upanayana, and starts his Gurukula study. So that 8-year-old boy, can he recite on a single day, more than 5 or 6 mantras? So 5 mantras is the number chosen, taking into account the age of a small Batu, okay? 8-year-old boy or girl, I mean, okay? Even girls had the Gurukulas. So 5 ruchas make one varga, some varga make one adhyaya, 8 adhyayas make one ashtaka, and entire Rigveda is divided into 8 ashtakas. That is 64 chapters or adhyayas. That is the traditional method. Even now in the Gurukulas, in the Veda Pathashalas, they recite, they teach according to Ashtaka Pratha. Okay? And the other thing is known as Dashatayi. Another name of Rigveda is Dashatayi. Dasheshu, Mandaleshu, Tayate, Tanyate. That which is stretched out in the 10 mandalas is called Dashatayi. There are 10 mandalas. 128 plus there are some Khila Suktas, so I said 1054 and 10,552 mantras, okay? The number of seers, 390 rishis. Some of them, 21 are the female seers, they are called rishikas. So the people who accuse us Indians that females were not educated, they were not trained, women education started only in the West and all, they should look here. There are female seers called Rishikas, okay? Second and the 8th mandala, 2nd to 8th mandala are called family or dynasty mandalas, called Kula mandalas. For example, in the Kula mandalas, we have the 2nd mandala written by or composed by, I can say, seen by Gritsamada. Gritsamada is the name of a seer. So he, his sons, their progeny, or even his disciples, they will be called Garthsamada. Gritsamadasya apatyam iti Garthsamada, taddita. Then Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra is the 3rd mandala. The famous Gayatri mantra comes in Vishwamitra mandala. Om Bhur Bhuvasvaha Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi. That famous mantra comes in the 3rd mandala, that is the Vishwamitra mandala. Okay? The 4th is known as Vamadeva mandala. I can tell you something interesting, but I have to complete this. There is Vamadeviya Prasuti, something like that. He talks about 418, I think it is the fourth mandala, 18th hymn. It is the birth of Indra and how Indra was born in a very unusual manner. And that unusual manner is something like a C-section or caesarean delivery of modern days. And therefore in Ayurveda, that type of delivery is even now called Vamadeviya Prasuti. Okay, so that is something different and I thought I must share it with you. Then Atri, the fifth mandala is Atri and his descendants, so Atreya Gotra Utpanna. Okay, and he is the one who refers to a solar eclipse. The first reference of solar eclipse comes in the fifth Atri mandala. Okay, and he calls Rahu as Swarbhanu. Svarbhanuna Grastaha, and you know, so that's a beautiful hymn of solar eclipse here. Sixth is Bharadvaja, sixth mandala is Bharadvaja. Seventh is Vasishtha, and in this Vasishtha mandala we have another famous mantra, which is Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanat Mrityor Mokshiyamamritat. So that famous mantra, Gayatri mantra is one famous mantra, Mahamrityunjaya mantra is another famous mantra. One is written by Vishwamitra, the other is written by Vasishtha in the seventh mandala. Eighth is Kanva Gotrotpanna, Pragatha Kanva, Kanva Angirasa, Kanva and his descendants. And then the ninth mandala is devoted to Soma. And another name of Soma is Pavamana. I think last lecture, if you remember, I told you that Soma was filtered through that woolen strainer. Then it becomes purified, right? Urna. Then it becomes Pavamana, pure. Okay? So Pavamana Mandala, Soma Mandala or Pavamana Mandala, that is the ninth one. And the first and the tenth, see, this is second to ninth we have come. First and the tenth are miscellaneous subjects and number of spheres, number of deities, number of chandas, everything is miscellaneous. In fact, an interesting thing is both the first and the tenth mandala have 191 suktas. 191 suktas. Possibly after compiling, you know, the suktas mandala wise and the Soma suktas in Pavamana mandala, whatever remaining suktas were there, they were divided equally. One was put in the first, one was in the end, Anubandha. Okay? I mean, this is just a guesswork. But both have 191. The first, Rigveda starts with Agnimile Purohitam. It ends with Sangachadvam, Sambadadvam, Samaniva, Kutihi, Samana, Hridayaniva. That Samanasya Sukta, it ends with that. See, such a great thing to happen. The beginning and the end are so very glorious. Suktas, so very glorious mantras. The content of the Rigveda, natural phenomena is praised, I told you. I want to draw your attention to, there are some mortal beings also deified like Yama, Rubhu and Ashwins. Maybe we'll take some of the suktas of Yama, Rubhu. Rubhu are like the Rutus. Rubhu are like the Rutus. They are the children of Dyava Prithivi. Okay, maybe sometime if time permits, we can take some suktas. I want to draw your attention to these two lines. Polytheism to henotheism to monotheism is the Western approach. When Western people, they studied Rigveda, they said there are so many deities, number of deities, number of gods are there. Okay? So it's a polytheism. Theos is God, poly is many, ism, sampradaya. But then, suppose you are praising Vishnu, at that particular time, that particular point of time, in the Vishnu Sukta, you will say, oh, Vishnu is the greatest of all the gods. He is the one who supported Dyava Prithivi. When it comes to Indra, you will say, Indra Odadhar Dyam Prithivyam Cha. That is called as henotheism or kathenotheism by Western scholars, especially Max Müller. Okay? Moksha Mullaraha, Max Müller. His name is Moksha Mullara in Sanskrit. Sharmanya Deshavasiyaha Moksha Mullaraha. Sharmanya is German. So, polytheism to henotheism or kathenotheism to monotheism is the journey of the Vedic gods till in the Vedanta we come to the Advaita, right? That is monotheistic or mono principle, ekameva advitiyam, ekameva advitiyam we say, right? So from Vedic to Vedantic, it is poly to heno to mono. That is their pravasa, that is their journey. I would rather say our Indian philosophical journey, our perspective is Indra Maya Bhihi Pururupa Iyate. There is only one God. Pururupa Iyate, he takes many forms. So one becoming many for the people, for the welfare, to achieve so many mundane goals and empirical development and what not, you know, Indra has to take so many different forms. If you any time see the Rigvedic mantras interpreted by Yogi Aravinda, Aravindo as he called, Yogi Aravinda, and Arya Samaji, Dayananda Swami, you know, they would rather say that every, after saying every deity, iti paramatma, iti parameshwaraha, Indra parameshwaraha, Vishnu parameshwaraha. So everything is one only, but it gets many forms, sizes, shapes and different names. So Indra Maya Vi Pururupayate. So that is an Indian approach, one becoming many. Then the deities, we will, when we discuss later, you know, in this lecture, I am not going to deal with all that. There are only 15 minutes left. Deities will take the legends about them, their stories, and for the stories of the deities of the Veda, we have a separate book called Brihad Devata. It was written by Shaunaka Rishi. Shaunaka Rishi. It is called Brihad Devata. Don't confuse it with Brihad Samhita. Brihad Samhita is written by Varaha Mihira, which is 6th, 7th century common era work. But Shaunaka's Brihad Devata is a very old book, very old text, Brihad Devata. And that supposedly has so many different narratives, legends, myths, you can call, of all the Vedic gods. So the Vedic mythology, as people say nowadays, it's mainly based on Brihad Devata. Okay? Basically, mythology, if you see, it's not just we sometimes, you know, common expression or common meaning of myth is that which is not true, that which is false, but that's not the dictionary meaning. Myth is a legend. Myth is something which has happened and which people know about. So maybe it is something like, you know, in the ballads, in the povada, Marathi we call it povada, ballad in English, there are some adventurous things, you know, glorified of a particular king. Now they may not be documented in a history, but they come by oral tradition. So myths are like that. There is an oral tradition for so many myths. So we just can't brush it off aside by saying, oh, it's a myth, it's not true. It's not that way, okay? Myths have the grain of truth. And when we say mythology or mythology, maybe, you know, like, we fabricate so many things around that grain that the main thing is lost sight of, and what we see is only the fabrication. That happens many times, okay? But so-called myths or the legends or the narratives, the stories of their feats, their adventures, all these are written down by Shaunaka in Brihad Devata. So when we see a deity of a Rigveda, we have to take into account the legends thereof, that of, then their exploits, the various epithets. For example, Ashwini Kumara, there are so many names. For Agni, there are so many names. What is the meaning of those names? Vishnu, I was telling you yesterday, Urugaya and Trivikrama. What are the meanings of these words, right? So all that comes, and we can interpret that with the help of Mimamsa, with the help of etymology, with the help of Vyakarana. These are all the Vedangas which come to our help, okay? So concept of Ruta, this is again a very great concept, and Varuna, for example, of the Rigvedic deity Varuna is called Ritavan. Usha is called Ritavari. They are the upholders. Rita is a cosmic order. Rita is a cosmic order. You know, we use the word Rita and Anrita as opposites. And Anrita is Asatya. And therefore, Rita we say Satya. Right? From Anrita to Rita, they are opposites. And Anrita is Asatya, falsehood, untruth. And therefore, Rita becomes Satya for us. But that is not the true meaning of Rita in the Rigveda. Rita is that which is constantly in flux. It's dynamic principle. Satya is static. Satya never changes. Whatever is Satya, it was the same in the past, it's the same in the present, it will be the same in the future. For example, Brahman, Asti, Satyam. You can't deny it, you can't challenge it, can't question it. It is Satya, Astitvam. But Rita is that which is Ru Gatau, Rushi Gatau. Gata, Gamana. See, you see the etymology, the meaning becomes clear. And this Rita is, you know, developed so very nicely. It has a cosmic principle as a Rita. And because of that, Surya Chandrama Saudhata Yatha Purvam Akalpayat. You know, when every creation, Dhata, that is the Srishtikarta, he created the sun and the moon and the seasons and all the 14 worlds as he had done in the earlier creation. Yatha Purvam Akalpayat. So there is an order in every creation. That's a cosmic order. Every day, you know, the day ends with a night. After night, there has to be a daybreak. Usha has to be there. You know, there is an order. The Rutus come in an order. Right? Rutus come in an order. Grishma would come. After that, Varsha would come. You have to be heated enough. Then only you will be soothed by the rain showers. Right? So everything comes by order. There is a cosmic order behind everything. That's a cosmic stage. On the terrestrial stage, it is Yajna. Rita developed into the concept of Yajna. Okay? Everything has to be done in a particular system. Systematically it has to be done. Yajna requires that. And I would rather go into a psychological realm and would say, there is a Rita in our psyche, you know. When we do something which is undesirable, our mind pricks us. Our conscience pricks us, oh, I shouldn't have done that. That is the Rita. So that is the controller. Controller of your psyche, of the cosmos, of the people around by Yajna. So Rita works on these two, three levels, okay? And then social, ritual, philosophical, cosmological aspect of Rigvedic Suktas. There are so many, I mean, content if you go on seeing, there are so many types under which you can categorize the suktas, the hymns of the Rigveda. Importance of the Vedas. Indian civilization is world's oldest and most developed one. We saw it in the very first lecture, right? Then uninterrupted flow of this rich culture and heritage is awesome. Is really awesome and attracts hundreds of Indian scholars as well as international scholars to the study of the Vedas. We can see who all have commented, who all have translated, how many foreign scholars have worked on the Vedas. There are so many foreign commentators in German, in English, in French, so many languages, so many scholars have translated the Rigveda, the earliest written literature, so to say. Then constant association of nature enabled the visionary seers develop outer world and pursuit of knowledge enrich their inner world. This I wrote because, you know, we are going to the exoteric and esoteric sciences. The outer world, constant association with the nature enabled them to develop the outer world. That turned into the exoteric sciences. Exoteric is bahya and esoteric is antara, abhyantara, okay, in Sanskrit. Bahya, public, and esoteric is sacred. It is inner, private, not public. So esoteric sciences is philosophy, advaita, mysticism, right? So all these are esoteric. They are for your self-growth, self-development, self-enrichment. Whereas there evolved so many sciences we will see how sciences are reflected in Sanskrit, or sciences as seen through Sanskrit literature. So both these, the association with nature, with exoteric sciences, in that exoteric sciences we have rasayana, we have biology, we have dermatology, we have metallurgy, we have vimana vidya, we have so many other things. We have pranishastra, botany, zoology, everything, horticulture, agriculture, everything we have. These are all exoteric sciences for the growth and development, for the prosperity of the people around, right? And then the esoteric sciences. I'll end with this slide. So many Vedic mantras are there, which are used variously by various institutions. Some of the big institutions, I mean, I have collected only 4 or 5. You can get a list by Google Baba, not with the sources, not with the source, of course. Sources I had to find, okay? So like Ano Bhadra Kratavo Yantu Vishwataha. Bhadraha Kratavaha, Vishwataha Ayantu, from all the directions, Bhadraha Kratavaha, noble thoughts. Kratu again is a very great term, we'll discuss it sometime. So let the noble thoughts come from all the directions. This is the motto of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. Okay, Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, the top there. Okay, Ano Bhadra Kratavo. Then Ritasya Dridha, Dridha becomes Dridha in the Veda, because Achmadhyasya Dakarasya Lakarasya, there is a rule according to that. It's a grammar, but I have written the word Dridha, because you can understand the meaning of Dridha, firm. Firm are the foundations of Rita. That happens to be a motto of Ritayan, of which I was a president some time ago in Mumbai, and it's a Sanskrit Lovers Association, but it's not a public institute, and therefore you can't find the logo on the Google, okay? So I didn't get a picture. I could have got it, but then I didn't try for that. Then Asatoma Sadgamaya is CBSE schools. Asatoma Sadgamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityorma Amritangamaya. Okay, lead us from ignorance to truth. Asatoma Sadgamaya. Tejasvinav Adhitamastu, it is IIM Bangalore. Tejasvinav Adhitamastu, every day in Chinmaya we start our classes, our prayer. Sahana Vavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinav Adhitamastu, Ma Vidvishavahai. So Tejasvi Nau Adhitamastu, let our learning be glorious, that is IIMB. Ya Esha Supteshu Jagarti, this is the motto of Indian Institute of Chartered Accountants. Chartered Accountants, when all others are sleeping, this institute is quite awake, right? So one who keeps awake when others are sleeping, Ya Esha Supteshu Jagarti. So this is from Yajurveda. So these are not Rigvedic, they are the Vedic quotations. So many Vedas you can get it. I mean, I just collected a few of them, and I think this is the Indian Association of the Indian Chartered Accountants, and then this is IIMB, this is CBSE school, Kendriya Madhyamik Vidyalaya, and this is the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. Like that you can have many more, like, you know, quotes which are used by various institutions as their mottos. So with this we close today, and maybe if I wait for the feedback, I get feedback from some other people from Mumbai and some of my friends, but if I get a feedback, I can plan my next lecture accordingly. I have planned, you know, I just tell you in advance that maybe in next lecture I would take up Indra as a deity, and how the various stages can be seen of personification, deification. Take one adventure of Indra, like Indra Vritra fight, that is the famous thing. In the entire Rigveda we have Indra Vritra Yuddha or fight. So what are the different interpretations of that, and how that Indra Vritra myth, so to say, or legend, or the narrative is translated through the time, till the modern times, how you can find variations in that. So does that interest you? Okay, with that I close. ओम असतो मा सद्गमय सोमा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतंगमय ओम शांति 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 ही हरि ही ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ही ओम।